We'll be right back. prayer, please. Order, please. We'll now proceed with the daily routine, presenting and reading of petitions. Presenting reports of committees. I recognize the Honourable Minister of Justice for presenting reports in committees.
Mr. Speaker, as chair of the Committee on Law Amendments, I'm directed to report that the committee has met and considered the following bill, Bill No. 7, an act to amend Chapter 376 of the Revised Statutes 1989, Public Service Act, respecting the Office of Communications, Nova Scotia. The committee recommends these bills to the favorable consideration of the House without amendment.
The report is tabled. Ordered that these bills be referred to the Committee of the Whole House on Bills. Tabling reports, regulations, and other papers. I recognize the Honourable Minister of Justice.
Mr. Speaker, I beg leave to table the 2012 to 2013 annual report of the Law Foundation of Nova Scotia.
The report is tabled. We'll move on to statements by ministers. We'll move on to government notices of motion. Recognize the Honourable Minister of Communities, Culture and Heritage.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I beg leave to introduce the following resolution on behalf of the Premier. Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on the future day I shall move to adopt the following resolution. Whereas there are a few people who will leave a mark as indelible on this earth as Nelson Mandela, and whereas people around the globe were inspired by his dignity and his unwavering commitment to freedom, and whereas Nelson Mandela's message of peace, forgiveness, and acceptance is one we all should all aspire to in whatever way we can in tribute to his memory. Therefore, be it resolved that all members of the House of Assembly extend their condolences to the Nelson Mandela family and the many he impacted around the world, and that Nova Scotians take a moment to pause, reflect on the life of this great man and all he has given to the global community. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a waiver. Request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion? I recognize the Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm very honoured that we have agreed, all of us, to just take a moment, each party, and speak to the resolution before we pass it, which I'm sure we will unanimously in a moment. And it is one of those times where we'll have one resolution and all parties will express their views and then deal with the resolution. Mr. Speaker, it's rare in the world where the loss of one human being is marked pretty well unanimously by the rest of the 6 or 7 billion of us, but today is one of those days. I can't think of an individual in my own lifetime where just about everyone on the planet feels some connection to another, in this case, Mr. Mandela of South Africa. I was struck this morning by the tributes that are pouring in to Nelson Mandela's family from around the world, including everyday people in the millions, and right up to the President of the United States, the Prime Minister of Canada, of course. But Mr. Obama, the President, said that his first political action was to attend an anti-apartheid rally. And Mr. Speaker, in no way am I comparing myself to the President of the United States, but the first political event I ever attended in my life as a young student at Dalhousie University was a Free Mandela concert at the Dalhousie Student Union Building in protest of the apartheid regime of South Africa, of the oppression of one peoples by another, and to demand that Mr. Mandela, who had stood up at great cost to his personal freedom to say it was wrong and to pledge himself, indeed his life, to fixing it. It was a big moment for a young Dalhousie student. And Mr. Speaker, I know I speak for not only all of the progressive conservatives, but all the people of Nova Scotia, as I'm sure the other parties will, in recognizing that we have lost a man who not only put his life at risk, but lost 27 years of his personal freedom in prison for his political beliefs, who then emerged from that famous jail cell to find a country divided, and he sought to unite it, a country of racism and bigotry and oppression, and sought to end it, a country of great hardship and poverty and death and destruction, and healed it. And at the moment of his greatest power, when he could have turned on his own oppressors, who literally had murdered his fellow citizens, sought truth and reconciliation. There is no greater symbol of hope for the world than what Nelson Mandela did for the hope for mankind. And so, Mr. Speaker, thank you for the opportunity to recognize that eternal truth, that one person, in this case, Nelson Mandela, truly can make the world a better place. And God rest his soul.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton Centre.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I would like to lend our party's voice to the many tributes worldwide to this great, great human being. You know, Mr. Speaker, in today's world, the word hero is thrown around oh so quickly over maybe some very minor matters, but there's nobody I would think that would personify the definition of that word more than the late Nelson Mandela. What he's done, you know, we think of our own struggles within this house and in a very minute way that they're great for us. We feel the burden of I'm sure the government feels the burden of governing, and we feel the burden of representation, as we all do in this house. But when you think of what the burden we put on our shoulders is so minuscule to the burden that was handed to Nelson Mandela, and he gladly accepted it. He accepted it with such calm and dignity. I can never recall whether it was an interview in the electronic media, or whether it was in newspaper, or whether it was a book about his life, that he ever complained, Mr. Speaker. And here we are today, you know, a man of 95 years who led, you know, we often hear say, he led a full life. Well, Mr. Speaker, Mr. Mandela not just led a full life, he led a great life. He led a life that lit the world, and that we will be ever grateful for that, because now he is a man that belongs to the ages, Mr. Speaker. He is a man that's transcended, I think, politics for the last half century. There's absolutely nobody that can put them in the category of a person that stood for their rights and stayed there and did it in such a perspective of the common man. The reality of when he talked about sports and how they brought everything together. They brought both the sorrows and the joy, but they were the model of how we should do it. And you know, there's been stories about Mr. Mandela while in prison, he would organize football or soccer games, if you will, Mr. Speaker. The greatness of the man when he brought rugby back to South Africa and he wore a Springboks jersey, Mr. Speaker. These are the things that he had talked about. He had not just talked about, he had done. So I'm going to take my place, Mr. Speaker, because in the reality, anything I could say or I would be just pure hyperbole in many, many, many sense, Mr. Speaker. He was a great man. He's transcended us all for years to come. And Mr. Speaker, I can only think that he is, in my religious belief, somewhere looking down and smiling today, saying, my work here is done. I will now rest. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. The motion is carried. Would you all please rise as we observe a moment of silence in honor of Nelson Mandela. Thank you. The Honourable Minister of Labour and Advanced Education.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas December 6 marks the National Day of Remembrance and Action on Violence Against Women, commemorating the anniversary of the murder of 14 engineering students at L'École Polytechnique in Montreal who died just because they were women. And whereas this day is also a time to bring to mind all the Nova Scotia women affected by violence, and whereas the province acknowledges, appreciates, and supports the frontline service providers in their tireless, steadfast efforts to help women whose lives have been affected by violence, therefore, be it resolved that government and community groups will continue to work collaboratively to improve the lives of women who have experienced violence. Together we have, together we can, together we will end violence against women. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed?
Agreed.
It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye. Contrary-minded, nay. The motion is carried. The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas the 24th Annual Christmas Festival of Trees and Crafts takes place this weekend in cooperation with the Natural Resources Education Center on Highway 224 in Middle Muscadabit, and whereas we invite all Nova Scotians to enjoy the entertainment, see the creations of more than 80 talented crafters, and experience the beauty of 30 decorated balsam fir trees donated by the province and the Lunenburg County Christmas Tree Producers Association. And whereas the festival starts with an opening ceremony Friday at 6 p.m. and runs throughout the weekend to spread good cheer and help promote real, natural Nova Scotia Christmas trees. Therefore, be it resolved that the members of this House of Assembly show their support for the annual Christmas Festival of Trees and Crafts. Mr. Speaker, I ask for waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed?
Agreed.
It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honorable Minister of the Public Service Commission.
Mr. Speaker, I'd like to give a warm welcome to four of the many dedicated employees that we have in the Public Service Commission today up in the East Gallery: Kathy Wiley, Rima Tomei, Nancy Gaudet, and Janet White. If we could have a round of applause from the House. I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas on Thursday, December 5th, the employees at the Public Service Commission donated more than 100 gifts to the Salvation Army's Angel Giving Trees. And whereas all of the gifts will be distributed to families in need of joy this holiday season. And whereas the Public Service Commission and employees have contributed hundreds of gifts to families in need since 2004. Therefore, be it resolved that the Nova Scotia Legislature congratulate organizer Kathy Wiley and the employees of the Public Service Commission for their generosity and gift giving. Mr. Speaker, I ask for waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed?
Agreed.
It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. The motion is carried. Just a reminder to all members, if you're looking for permission to do an introduction, you must request permission first from the Speaker. The Honorable Minister of Communities, Culture and Heritage.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day, I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas December the 6th, is an opportunity for Nova Scotians and Canadians to look back at the Halifax explosion of 1917 as a defining moment in the history of the province, and whereas in commemoration of the tragic event, the Nova Scotian Archives will be live tweeting the events of the Halifax explosion throughout the day, much the same way as the messages were sent out over the wire almost a century ago, and whereas the Nova Scotian Archives is is reaching out to Nova Scotians to collect stories about the impact the explosion had on their lives. Therefore, be it resolved that the members of the House of the Assembly take a moment to remember the 2,000 people who died from the explosion and its aftermath, and wish the Nova Scotian Archives success as they continue to capture the moment that has deeply affected people of Nova Scotia for almost a century ago. Mr. Speaker, I ask for waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed?
Agreed.
It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. The motion is carried. The Honourable Minister of Transportation and Infrastructure Renewal.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I hereby give notice that on a future day, I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas 78 people have been killed this year on Nova Scotia highways, and whereas the main causes of these deaths are speeding, distracted driving, driving without a seatbelt, and impaired driving. And whereas during the first week of December, Canadians are recognizing Safe Driving Week with a special focus on the dangers of driving while impaired by alcohol, drugs, or fatigue. Therefore, be it resolved that all members of this House encourage Nova Scotia drivers at all times of the year, but especially as we enter the holiday season, to travel unimpaired and alert. And always remember, crosswalk safety is a shared responsibility. Mr. Speaker, I ask for waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed?
Agreed.
It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. The motion is carried. We'll now move on to introduction of bills. I recognize the Honourable Minister of Labour and Advanced Education.
Mr. Speaker, I beg leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 475 of the Revised Statutes of 1989, the Trade Union Act.
The Honourable Minister of Labour and Advanced Education begs leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 475 of the Revised Statutes 1989 of the Trade Union Act.
Bill number 19, entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 475 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Trade Union Act.
Ordered that the bill be read a second time on a future day. Recognize the Honorable Minister of Justice.
Speaker, I beg leave to introduce an act to amend Chapter 1, 1992 Supplement of the Revised Statutes 1989 of the House of Assembly Act.
The Honorable Minister of Justice begs leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 1, 1992 Supplement of the Revised Statutes 1989 of the House of Assembly Act.
Bill number 20, entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 1, 1992 Supplement of the Revised Statutes 1989 of the House of Assembly Act.
Ordered that the bill be read a second time on a future day. The Honourable Member for Pictou West.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I beg leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 475 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Trade Union Act, respecting first contract arbitration.
The Honourable Member for Pictou West begs leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 475 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Trade Union Act, respecting the first contract arbitration.
Bill number 21, entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 475 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Trade Union Act, respecting first contract arbitration.
Ordered that the bill be read a second time on a future day. The Honourable Member for Inverness.
Mr. Speaker, I beg leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Provide Greater Flexibility for Nova Scotians' Retirement Savings in Locked-In Accounts.
The Honourable Member for Inverness begs leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Provide Greater Flexibility for Nova Scotians' Retirement Savings in Locked-In Accounts.
Bill number 22, entitled An Act to Provide Greater Flexibility for Nova Scotians' Retirement Savings in Locked-In Accounts.
Ordered that the bill be read a second time on a future day. The Honourable Member for Inverness.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I beg leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 246 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Labor Standards Code.
The Honourable Member for Inverness begs leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 246 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Labor Standards Code.
Bill number 23, entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 246 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Labor Standards Code.
Ordered that the bill be read a second time on a future day. The Honourable Member for Inverness.
Mr. Speaker, I beg leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 340 of the Revised Statutes 1989. And Chapter 41 of the Acts of 2011, the Pension Benefits Act.
The Honourable Member for Inverness begs leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 340 of the Revised Statutes 1989 and Chapter 41 of Acts 2011 of the Pension Benefits Act.
Bill number 24, entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 340 of the Revised Statutes 1989 and Chapter 41 of the Acts of 2011, the Pension Benefits Act.
Ordered that the bill be read a second time on a future day. We'll now move on to notices of motion. I recognize the Honourable Minister of Service, Nova Scotia and Municipal Relations.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Constable Brandy Steves of the Bridgewater Detachment of the RCMP and Constable Susan Foote of the Chester Detachment of the RCMP have received awards from the 2013 Atlantic Women in Law Enforcement Conference. And whereas Brandy and Susan were recognized with the Atlantic Women Law Enforcement Team Endeavor Award for having helped to create the Lunenburg County RCMP Youth Advisory Committee and Name the Shame Initiative. And whereas Brandy and Susan are working to bring Lunenburg County youth and law enforcement together on issues of bullying and other youth issues and offering resources and information to the community. Therefore, be it resolved that all members of the House of Assembly congratulate Brandy and Susan for their achievements and wish them continued success in the future. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed?
Agreed.
It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. The motion is carried. The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
If I give notice, on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas today marks the 96th anniversary of the Halifax explosion, when the SS Mont Blanc, loaded with wartime explosives, collided with the Norwegian vessel SS Emo. Whereas the resulting explosion was the largest man-made explosion prior to the development of nuclear weapons and caused the death of 2,000 people and injury to 9,000 others. And whereas within hours, stoic survivors formed the Halifax Relief Committee to organize medical relief and to supply food and shelter to victims of the explosion. Therefore, be it resolved that all members of this House remember the victims of the Halifax explosion with sadness today, as well as the resilience and bravery of the survivors who rallied to help one another in the wake of the devastating blast. And Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed?
Agreed.
It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. The motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Cape Breton Centre.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I read this on behalf of the Leader of the New Democratic Party. I hereby give notice on the future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas each year on December 6th, Nova Scotians remember the explosion of 1917 as a significant moment in the history of our province. Whereas in recognizing the importance of the day, Nova Scotians pay tribute to the 2,000 people who lost their lives and the legacy they left behind. And whereas once again this year, a crowd will gather at the Memorial Bell Tower at Fort Needham Park to pause for a moment to remember an event that has lasted many lifetimes. Therefore, be it resolved that all members of this House take a moment today to remember the 2,000 people who died from the Halifax explosion in 1917. Speaker, I ask for waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed?
Agreed.
It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried. I'd request that all members please rise and observe a moment of silence for the victims of the Halifax explosion. Thank you. The Honourable Member for Argyle-Barrington.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I hereby give notice on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas 24 years ago today, 14 women fell victim to a hate crime against feminism at École Polytechnique in Montreal, and the events of that day become known as the Montreal Massacre. And whereas in honor of these women, today has been named the National Day of Remembrance and Action on Violence Against Women. And whereas this day serves as an opportunity for Canadians to reflect on the phenomenon of violence against women in our society and consider concrete actions to eliminate gender-based violence in our communities. Therefore, be it resolved that all members of this House of Assembly acknowledge the significance of today and remember the women and girls in our country who have lost their lives to violence, and in particular, those 14 women in Montreal. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. The motion is carried. Would all members please rise and observe a moment of silence for the victims of École Polytechnique. Thank you. The Honourable Member for Truro, Bible Hill, Millbrook, Salmon River.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas on this date in 1989, an armed gunman took the lives of 14 female students at École Polytechnique in Montreal. And whereas December 6th has become a day to remember the lives lost and changed forever in this tragedy, as well as women who are currently living as victims of abuse. And whereas, in an effort to pay tribute to all women who have faced battles against violence, we must remain vigilant and stand together against what we all know is, quite simply, wrong. Therefore, be it resolved that all members of this legislature and all Nova Scotians remember the massacre at École Polytechnique in Montreal on December 6, 1989, and remain steadfast in our resolve to end violence against women and girls in all their forms. And, Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. The motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Sackville-Beaverbank.
Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day, I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas a group of Sackville residents in 2007 formed the Woodbine Family Association to provide hot meals to anyone over 50 who could not afford to make hot meals for themselves. Whereas over the years, in addition to providing meals, this group has raised money for many community projects, such as planting trees and the purchase of playground equipment. Whereas this group of dedicated individuals, Bonnie Ryan, Tanya Hansen, Kathy Fugier, Raymond Grove, Joan Grove, and Barb Burke, as well as many volunteers, continue to provide meals free of charge to those in need. Anyone who can afford to pay is asked for a $5 donation to keep the cupboard stocked. And they need not live in Woodbine Trailer Park. All are welcome. Therefore, be it resolved that the members of this House of Assembly recognize the Woodbine Family Association for their selfless dedication to providing for their neighbors. Mr. Speaker, I ask for waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. The motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Truro, Bible Hill, Millbrook, Salmon River.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day, I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas former Indian Brook Chief Reginald Reg Maloney passed away on Tuesday, December 3rd, 2013, at the age of 72, with family and friends by his side. And whereas Reg Maloney served as chief of the Shubenacadie Band as well as band counselor, acted as Grand Captain on the Grand Council, and served as District Chief. And whereas Reg Maloney will be fondly remembered for his passion for family, friends, nature, and politics, and as an influential advocate for the Mi'kmaq First Nation and their laws and rights. Therefore, be it resolved that this House of Assembly extends its sincere condolences to the family and friends of Reg Maloney, and may his exemplary passion for Aboriginal rights and laws be carried on. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There's been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried. I recognize the Honorable Government House Leader. Do you have a notice, or are we moving on?
We're moving on.
Okay, we'll move on to orders of the day with the Government House Leader.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, could you please call Government Business Bills for second reading?
Government Bills for second reading.
Speaker, could you please call Bill Number 14, the Justice of the Peace Act and the Court Provincial Act?
Bill Number 14, an act to amend Chapter 244 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Justices of the Peace Act, and Chapter 238 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Provincial Court Act. I recognize the Honorable Minister of Justice.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I move that Bill Number 14, Amendments to the Justice of the Peace Act and Provincial Court Act, be now read a second time. Mr. Speaker, it's my pleasure to speak on a brief overview of this bill. The amendments being proposed result from a Nova Scotia Supreme Court decision. Delivered in February of this year, the court ruled that an independent process was needed to provide compensation for presiding justices of the peace in Nova Scotia. The Department of Justice was given 12 months to make these changes. Mr. Speaker, we were of the impression that we were already providing fair and adequate compensation to our presiding justices. However, the court disagreed. We all know, Mr. Speaker, that in a democratic society like ours, everyone has the right to make their case. And the court has the ability to make an independent decision. And in this case, Mr. Speaker, the court ruled that a new compensation process is needed, and we accept that decision. And by introducing these legislative changes, we are acting on that decision. So, Mr. Speaker, there's no doubt that justices of the peace perform important tasks like issuing warrants and emergency protection orders to free up judges' time. The court determined that a remuneration scheme must be introduced for presiding justices of the peace that meets constitutional requirements to protect independence. Mr. Speaker, this new legislation provides exactly that. It creates a new independent process to set compensation for presiding justices of the peace. It's an objective, efficient, and a fair process. It creates a tribunal structure for determining compensation. To be more efficient, the chair of the judges' compensation tribunal will also act as a one-person tribunal for the presiding justices of the peace. We are recommending this tribunal model for a few reasons, Mr. Speaker. First, it's an important to create a structure that's cost-effective and efficient. Second, Mr. Speaker, there's a small number of presiding justices of the peace. There's only 13 part-time justices of the peace in the province of Nova Scotia, and a one-person tribunal, the chair of the judges' tribunal, who has already heard all of the common economic evidence, is the most cost-efficient model reviewed. And finally, Mr. Speaker, this model is also used in the province of Saskatchewan. So, Mr. Speaker, we are also introducing amendments to align the timing of salaries and benefits. Tribunal reports for judges and presiding justices of the peace coinciding with government's budget preparation process. These amendments proposed that after an adjustment period, the reports will start at the beginning of the fiscal year following the year the report is submitted. As I mentioned earlier, Mr. Speaker, the amendments brought forth today are the result of a Supreme Court of Nova Scotia decision to create an independent process to set compensation for presiding justices of the peace in Nova Scotia. Thank you.
Recognize the Honourable Member for Inverness.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, justices of the peace are owed the same honour and consideration as our provincial judges. And as such, it is fitting that we afford them the same model for compensation. We rely on them to perform any duties that include issuing warrants, arraignment trials, issuing subpoenas, oaths of office, and performing civil weddings, to name a few. Without the hard work of these people, our justice system would not function as it does today. They provide professional consultation and are responsible for essential services. Mr. Speaker, in February, when the Supreme Court of Nova Scotia ruled that they be granted the same compensation model as provincial judges, it became apparent that this change needed to be made. Allowing compensation to be set by an independent board will ensure a transparent and fair process is put in place for these valuable civil servants. Mr. Speaker, we, the Progressive Conservative Caucus, will be supporting this legislation. Thank you.
If I'm to recognize the Honourable Minister of Justice, it will be to close debate.
Mr. Speaker, I move that we close debate on Bill number 14.
The motion is for second reading of Bill number 14, an act to amend Chapter 244 of the Revised Statutes 1989. The Justices of the Peace Act and Chapter 238 of the Revised Statutes 1989 of the Provincial Court Act. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried.
Bill number 14, entitled an act to amend Chapter 244 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Justices of the Peace Act, and Chapter 238 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Provincial Court Act.
Ordered that the bill be referred to the Committee on Law Amendments. The Honourable Government House Leader.
Mr. Speaker, would you please call Bill number 15, the February Holiday Act.
Bill number 15, an act to establish a holiday in February. I recognize the Honourable Minister of Labour and Advanced Education.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I move that Bill number 15, an act to establish a holiday in February, be now read a second time. Mr. Speaker, for nearly a decade, my colleague, the Honourable Minister of Finance and Treasury Board and the member for Clayton Park, has lobbied for a holiday for Nova Scotians to enjoy in February. The February Holiday Act delivers on our commitment to hardworking Nova Scotians while giving businesses the time they need to plan for a new holiday. Nova Scotians have told us repeatedly that a midwinter break is something they want. Now we're able to make that happen. Nova Scotians deserve a break between New Year's and Easter. I'm continuously inspired by the hard work, determination, and optimism of the people of this province. Nova Scotians know how to work hard, and at the same time, they value family and community. The new statutory holiday will be marked on the third Monday, beginning in February 2015. It will support that important work-life balance, and it gives people time to spend with their families and friends, just as a majority of Canadians already do. Now, you'll notice the new holiday doesn't have a name yet. As promised, we'll reach out to young Nova Scotians to help decide what the February holiday should be called. And we'll share more information on that process in the next couple of months. Mr. Speaker, six other provinces enjoy statutory holidays in February. Adding a February holiday will give Nova Scotia workers and families a total of six statutory holidays per year. Research shows that three-day weekends pay off with more productivity and less absenteeism. Some businesses have already been giving their staff a break during the long winter months. Businesses like McLeod Lorway Group, a local family-run insurance brokerage. They've been a little ahead of the curve, and they've been giving their 75 employees a day off in February for the past 3 years. They, like us, recognize a little time away can make for a much more productive time at work. Mr. Speaker, I'm pleased to move this legislation for second reading today.
The Honourable Member for Pictou West.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I'm pleased to rise and say a few words about Bill 15, the February Holiday Act. And as appealing as it sounds and lovely as it sounds, I just don't think it's the most important priority that Nova Scotians have to deal with right now. Mr. Speaker, Nova Scotia's economy is sick. There aren't enough jobs. Too many people are struggling to make ends meet. The priority of the Progressive Conservative Party is to fix the economy by getting the fundamentals right, by creating the conditions that will jumpstart the economy and create much-needed jobs. I recognize that February can be a long and dark month, but at this time, a February holiday is just not a priority for the PC caucus, and I don't believe it's a priority for the rest of Nova Scotians, especially those ones that are not working. MLAs, like so many other Nova Scotians, struggle to get work-life balanced right. Many of us understand the guilt that comes with feeling your family suffers because of the demands of your job. A single day off in February will not alleviate that guilt or put our lives back into a balance. I'm also concerned about what a statutory holiday will do to the dozens of small Nova Scotia businesses that are already struggling. And we have to remember, small businesses make up 52% of businesses here in Nova Scotia, and they're definitely not in favour of this holiday. With the highest taxes that we pay, the highest power rates, and expensive government red tape that we have. The Canadian Federation of Independent Business also has concerns about the cost of a February holiday to small businesses in our province. The CFIB estimates that this holiday will cost Nova Scotia economy $139 million. And this morning, the Halifax Chamber of Commerce spoke out against this holiday, saying it's not the right time. And that's simply what we believe as well. I think the whole idea of it is great. I just don't think that we are in favour of having it right now. Maybe in a couple years, when the economy gets a little bit better, it would be a consideration. Businesses simply can't afford it. The Canadian Restaurant and Food Services Association says the holiday will cost Nova Scotia restaurants about $2 million. So add that $2 million with the $140 million, it's going to cost us. Mr. Speaker, we need to ask ourselves, if our province is in a position to take that kind of hit, I think we can all say no to that. We've been hit hard enough. Are we really ready to make this a priority with our economy being as fragile as it already is? We have a debt of $14 billion. We have among the highest taxes in the country, and our growth lags behind the national average. Taking $140 million out of our economy will only worsen the problems that too many Nova Scotians face. One of the other things that I heard this morning from one of my colleagues after speaking to a number of teachers last night, which I found really interesting, is that they said this holiday means nothing to them. It doesn't make any sense, because what's going to happen is they're going to take the holiday, but they have to tag that day on at the end of the year when the weather is actually really nice and people want to be outside and enjoying a day. So to them, it makes no sense, which, I really appreciate that. I think we really have to consider this. It's not that we're totally against this bill, but we are against it right now. When you consider what the cost will be, so... Mr. Speaker, for these reasons, the Progressive Conservative Caucus will not support this Bill 15.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton Centre.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, while I agree with some of what the previous speaker said, I think their Mike Harris is showing, but Mr. Speaker, I'm worried about how far it's been consulted, and anytime this time of year, I think of the restaurant industry. It's a very tough time for them. It's probably talking to too many owners that it is a time where really they're really juggling whether to pay for the last food order or their wages and so on. So it's a difficulty. But Before I get too far down there, it's Nova Scotians work hard, you know, and I'm not, like, I don't know, and I just heard a chirp there, if they work. Well, Mr. Speaker, again, I'm not going to criticize the government of the day because they're... Let me finish. Just stop it there. Stop the tape. No, Mr. Speaker. No, there's no... I'm not going to criticize the government of the day for bringing in forward-thinking legislation for workers' rights. No, you don't have to brace yourself, folks. This is, I see this as, you know, as a progressive piece of legislation. I'm worried, you know, about some of the unintended consequences, and I'm going to politely ask the government to make sure that they're considered. I'm not going to get into the sky is falling because Nova Scotians get a day off of work. No.
Order, please. The Honourable Member for Cape Breton Centre has the floor.
Why, thank you, Mr. Speaker. This is reasonable. But I again, all I want to do is just caution the government. I know the member for Clayton Park has been to say she was passionate about this would be putting it on the downside of it, and that's fine. But I would hope that the government really does genuinely spend the time between now and February of 2015 to get it right. That small businesses in particular are protected by it. I mean, they're, you know, it's a statutory holiday. The idea that what this is going to impose on them is a burden. And I don't know what people will really do with this holiday. It's obviously in the middle of the winter. I guess one good thing about it being in the middle of winter, people are not going to go far afield because of the weather. So it may mean upside in as much as if they go somewhere, they'll spend money locally. So that may be a good unintended consequence. But Mr. Speaker, our party supports the working women, men of this province and more importantly, the families, that they get to spend some time together. And so I would ask the government to be careful in crafting the regulations around this bill and to make sure that there's the least interruption done to the employers of this province around this bill. I welcome this bill, I support this bill, and to the member of Clayton Park, job well done.
Honourable Minister of Finance.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I've been asked to be rather short in my remarks this morning, and you can appreciate that's difficult. I certainly want to speak thank the member opposite for his comments. I appreciate that very much, and the acknowledgement that I have been working on this for a number of years. Mr. Speaker, when I was first elected 10 years ago to this House, I had young children. I understand what it's like to have a busy life and juggle a lot of different things. And I listened to my constituents, who, in fact, one of my constituents brought this idea to me in 2003. She said she lived in Alberta where they'd had it for over 20 years, and what a wonderful thing it was. Initially, I thought this might be a lightweight sort of issue. I no longer think that because we have the fewest holidays of any jurisdiction in this country. And Mr. Speaker, not the fewest by one or two, the fewest by a lot. We have five holidays, and the average in the country is eight or more. Six provinces now have the February holiday. When I introduced the bill first, only one had it. Other provinces see the benefit for a winter country to have a day off in the winter. And, Mr. Speaker, it's not only long and dreary, it's a time when we can get out and have fun with our families and get together and recharge our batteries. And I know that the member from Pictou West will be hearing from some of her constituents who will enjoy this, who will look forward to it. The public is in favour of it, and more so as the years have gone by and they've realised that we have the fewest holidays in the country. That's just not a place we should be if we want to attract young people, keep our young people here in the province, be a competitive place to live. And how long can we say what a great quality of life we have if we have no statutory holidays? Mr. Speaker, this has been supported a lot by the public, but not only by the public, by progressive companies. And more, as other provinces have adopted a February holiday, companies that are working nationally have begun to give their people the day off here. Last February, on that day, I was interviewed by Global, which is part of the Shaw Communications Group. They were off across the country. They gave all of their employees that day, only the skeleton staff at work that day to keep the TV cameras rolling, but everybody would get a day off in lieu. It's the trend. These companies are seeing it in their other offices across the country. I mentioned that in the U.S., it's a day where they're shut down across the country. It's President's Day. And because of that, the stock markets are closed. When Ontario began to celebrate this day, the Ontario stock market closed. That means there are no business taking place in financial services across the country. We've had support as well from companies like Beacon Securities, who said for them it's just a day to catch up on paperwork. Many of their investment advisors and so on do not come to work that day because there's no trading. It's not happening. And again, more and more are companies that are in business that want to call their suppliers in Ontario, Alberta, BC, Manitoba, PEI, for heaven's sakes. They all have that day off, so business isn't happening if you're going to be talking to those provinces. So more and more, even Nova Scotians, regular everyday Nova Scotians, are realizing that their family and friends who are living in Ontario or in Alberta and the other provinces I named, six provinces in Canada that have that holiday, they're realizing they have the day off, they're having a long weekend, or they're coming to visit here in Nova Scotia, but we don't have it. And we are connected to the rest of the country. We need to be, I think, alert to where we stand in terms of holidays. And this single additional holiday will not even put us into the average for Canadian holidays, let alone anywhere near the top. Alberta has 10 holidays. I believe there's 11 in Saskatchewan, paid statutory holidays. And in Saskatchewan, when they introduced their Family Day, which they call it, they had just as much outcry from CFIB as we'll hear here in Nova Scotia. It is the mandate of CFIB and other business organizations to speak for their members and to point out the cost. We have to understand that and respect that. They're doing what they need to do. But honestly, Mr. Speaker, it was once said to me that we should leave all the holidays to the business community. In fact, somebody from the Chamber of Commerce said, you know, government shouldn't do that. Well, for heaven's sakes, would we have any statutory holidays if we left it to the business community? Would we have children working in mines if we left it to the business community? We are responsible for health and wellness. We are responsible for the labour standards of this province. And that's what this relates to. We have to set a balance. And we're very conscious of the impact on business. I think what's been missed a little bit, although the member from Cape Breton, I'm not sure of his new riding. What is it? Centre, Cape Breton Centre. The member from Cape Breton Centre did point out there are benefits to this holiday. And one reason why the Minister of Labour has chosen to wait a full year to introduce it is so that business can capitalise on the benefits. And that's very important. Mr. Speaker, in the provinces that have this holiday, it has become a winter festival. They have tourism events, they have reasons to celebrate in their communities, and definitely people are going out for food and beverage to speak to the Food and Beverage Association. When people get together and they come to town to skate at the Oval or to attend a play in whatever community, whatever place they're going to, they usually go out for a hot chocolate with their children or for a dinner with their family. So there's going to be a benefit in what is actually the slowest month of the entire year for food and beverage sales. February is, bar none, the worst one. So, Mr. Speaker, I know I'm going to get another opportunity to rise on this. I'm being urged to move this along so we can go to law amendments. The real reason is we want to hear from the people of Nova Scotia. My last comment, just to go to the business community, because we are concerned about them, is that the CFIB themselves do annual or frequent surveying of their members. And several years ago, they asked them about the February holiday, and nearly 40% of the respondents said they were in favor. So even in that strong business group, 40% several years ago were in favor, and I would bet you it's higher today. Mr. Speaker, thank you very much.
If I'm to recognize the Minister of Labour, it will be to close debate on Bill number 15. The Honourable Minister of Labour.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I would like to thank all of my colleagues in the House for their considered thoughts on this bill, no matter which side they come down on. I do value your input. I would like to also congratulate my colleague, the Minister of Finance, who today showed us what persistence looks like. And I can say that I'm looking forward to the February holiday in 2015. I can tell you that when my when we would get a snow day, when my kids were little, there was nothing better than staying in our jammies, popping some popcorn, and watching a movie. So I'm looking forward to that. I now move to close debate on Bill 15.
The motion is for second reading of Bill number 15, an act to establish a holiday in February. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. The motion is carried.
Bill number 15, entitled An Act to Establish a Holiday in February.
Ordered that this bill be referred to the Committee on Law Amendments. I recognize the Government House Leader.
Mr. Speaker, could you please call Bill number 17, Executive Council Act and Public Service Act.
Bill number 17, an act to amend Chapter 155 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Executive Council Act, and Chapter 376 of the Revised Statute 1989, the Public Service Act. I recognize the Government House Leader.
Thank you very much, Speaker. On behalf of the Premier, I move that Bill number 17, an act to amend Chapter 155 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Executive Council Act, and Chapter 376 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Public Service Act, be now read a second time. Mr. Speaker, I am pleased to rise in the House to introduce these housekeeping amendments that will formalize the new structure of government departments. In November, we announced that Executive Council had approved the establishment of Treasury and Policy Board, Issues Committee, and Legislation Committee. The amendments to the Executive Council Act and Public Service Act will create the new Treasury and Policy Board and update language in the Act to reflect this change and recent changes to department names and mandates. Specifically, these amendments will update the Executive Council Act and Public Service Act to be consistent with the change of name and mandates for the Departments of Education and Early Childhood Development and Finance and Treasury Board and the Office of Planning and Priorities. Remove the Chair of Treasury Board from the Executive Council Act as the Treasury Board Committee and Treasury Board Office no longer exists, and repeal provisions relating to Treasury Board, Policy and Priorities Committee, and Economic Investment Committee, and establish the Treasury and Policy Board and set out its objects and mandate. Other housekeeping amendments will update the Executive Council Act to correct a reference to the Lieutenant Governor and amend the provision relating to acting ministers to allow for retroactive appointments to be consistent with the provision for acting ministers in the Public Service Act. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Recognize the Honourable Member for Northside Westmount.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And we realize this is a housekeeping bill that reflects changes in the structure of the government, names of the departments, and errors in the existing bill. And we, the Progressive Conservative Caucus, will support these changes and look forward to passing through law amendments. Thank you.
If I'm to recognize the Government House Leader, it will be to close debate on Bill number 17. The Honourable House Leader.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and certainly appreciate the comments from the member from Northside Westmount, is that right? Keep all these writing name changes intact. Mr. Speaker, certainly as indicated, it is a housekeeping measure, but one that does require legislation to reflect the changes that have been made within the structure of government. So I appreciate the support from all sides of the House, and with that would move to close debate on Bill number 17.
The motion is for second reading of Bill number 17. An Act to amend Chapter 155 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Executive Council Act, and Chapter 376 of the Revised Statute 1989, the Public Service Act. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. The motion is carried.
Rule number 17, entitled An Act to amend Chapter 155 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Executive Council Act, and Chapter 376 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Public Service Act.
Ordered that this bill be referred to the Committee on Law Amendments. The Honourable Government House Leader.
Mr. Speaker, would you please call Government Motions, Address, and Reply.
We'll move on to Address and Reply. I recognize the Honourable Member for Kings South.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It is an honour for me to rise and reply to the speech from the throne. And I want to thank Lieutenant Governor J.J. Grant, the Honourable J.J. Grant, for delivering the throne speech. I will begin today by congratulating you, Mr. Speaker, for the remarkable achievements in your life and for the honour that you have bestowed on this House in serving as Speaker. I share the view of our Premier that your balanced, conciliatory, and collegial nature will ensure our Assembly is governed with civility and respect. I also want to offer my congratulations to my MLA colleague from Hants East on her appointment to Deputy Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Speaker, we have serving as Speaker and Deputy Speaker two individuals who are an inspiration to Nova Scotians. Mr. Speaker, it is a privilege to be here today representing the citizens of King South. During the course of the election campaign, I visited over 6,300 doors of citizens in my riding, from the Annapolis Valley First Nation in Cambridge in the West End, through Colebrook, New Minas, Wolfville, the Gaspereau Mountain, White Rock, to Grand Pre, Avonport, and the Glooskap First Nation near Hants border on the eastern end of the riding. I have come to this legislature equipped with their hopes and dreams for this province, their concerns and advice on improving government services, and their faith that collectively we will make decisions in the best interest of Nova Scotians. Mr. Speaker, in southwestern Nova Scotia, in a graveyard outside of Hebron, lies my great-great-grandfather, Whitman Butler. Not many details are known of Whitman Butler's life to me, but however, I do know this. In 1865, at age 28, he achieved his master's mariner papers. I know this because I have these papers with me today, enclosed in a metal storage container that went with my great-great-grandfather on board the bark, the Mary Killam, built in Salmon River. He sailed this wooden sailing ship out of Yarmouth to South America 150 years ago. He achieved his Master Mariner's credentials when Sir Charles Tupper, one of our Fathers of Confederation, who was schooled at Horton Academy in my riding, was our premier, the premier who would lead Nova Scotia into Confederation. Knowing that my great-great-grandfather was involved in the early trade economy of this province while Sir Charles Tupper walked the halls of this building, Province House, contemplating decisions around Confederation has given me a great sense of history and continuity to the task of province building that lies ahead for us. These Mariner Papers serve as my reminder that each generation has a responsibility to lead where we have not yet been, and to make decisions that will improve upon the circumstances of today's citizens and lay a sound foundation for the next generation. I want to assure the people of King South that each and every day I will diligently undertake this responsibility on their behalf. Mr. Speaker, following my graduation from the School of Architecture at the Technical University of Nova Scotia in 1982, I embarked on a journey that would take me to Switzerland to work as an architect in training, to West Africa as a volunteer, and then to Canada's Arctic as a practicing architect. My experience in volunteering with Canadian Crossroads International at a small school in the bush of Cameroon for 4 months changed my life. It opened my eyes to the importance and rewards of volunteerism and community service. Volunteer board work became a significant part of my life, which then led me to serve my community through elected service at the municipal level. I've slayed a few dragons along the way in these roles, which I hope will come in handy in the days ahead. Mr. Speaker, we heard in the speech from the throne last week some sobering facts about the performance of Nova Scotia's economy in the last decade and the resulting outmigration of our citizens. Sadly, the Annapolis Valley has not been exempt from these trends. At hundreds of doors during the election campaign, I heard from people who want this government to make decisions that will provide opportunities for their children and grandchildren to stay in this province, and even perhaps their great-great-grandchildren. In the months leading up to the election, I took the opportunity to attend a presentation by Ray Ivany on the interim report of the Nova Scotia Commission on Building the New Economy. In my opinion, Mr. Speaker, Mr. Ivany and the Commission are undertaking one of the most important assignments of our generation, developing a roadmap for Nova Scotia's next economy. We are fortunate that early in the life of our new government, we will receive the Commission's report and decide where and how to act on its recommendations. The work of the Commission to date has a core message, which is this: we must be ready to do things differently. If we approach the development of our economy as we have in the past, we should not be surprised we get the same result. The Commission will be presenting a challenge to the people of Nova Scotia on what it will take to build a new economy, and I will be accepting that challenge on behalf of the citizens of King South. I am already seeing encouraging investments in innovation in small and medium-sized businesses in King South. 2 weeks ago, I attended the grand opening of the Center for Innovation and Incubation Services at Acadia University, which is helping small entrepreneurs with innovation in their information technology needs. This is the type of collaboration we must promote to build the next economy. And by that, I mean harnessing the research capacity within our universities with the knowledge potential of our students to foster innovation in small and medium-sized businesses in our communities. Mr. Speaker, I also attended an event at Alderney Landing last month with my colleague from Preston Dartmouth, the Minister of Agriculture, for the celebration of the 19 agribusinesses invested in by FarmWorks Investment Cooperative. Linda Best, one of the founding members of FarmWorks and a constituent of mine, has said to me numerous times, if we could just harness a small percentage of the millions of dollars Nova Scotians invest outside this province and put that money into our own food production and distribution businesses in this province, we can create rural jobs and increase access to rural food supply. FarmWorks enables these types of investments. Mr. Speaker, in the last few years, we've witnessed a remarkable shift in agriculture in King's South towards higher value crops like high bush blueberries, high value apples, and grapes, and this is transforming our agricultural land and our economy. It was encouraging to read last week's paper that farming in Nova Scotia is becoming a more lucrative business. Statistics Canada released data that showed that the net income of Nova Scotia farmers doubled to $52 million in 2012, up from $26 million a year previous. While some caution that this growth is from a particularly bad year, we are the only province to show an increase in the number of farms between 2006 and 2012. We know that our farmers face tight margins, but I have to say the growth reported by Statistics Canada in Nova Scotia agribusiness is something that I am seeing every day in King's South, in our farmers' markets, in the number of restaurants now promoting locally sourced food, in our festivals such as the Devour Food and Film Festival that just concluded, and in the visitors that are packing our winery bus every summer and fall. Mr. Speaker, I believe there's a considerable potential in building our next economy around the innovation in agriculture, cultural and tourism industries, particularly in rural areas of Nova Scotia, like my own riding of King's South. Embracing this vision means advancing the discussion on protecting our farmlands, and this does not have to involve new study. In 2010, the Nova Scotia Land Review Committee, chaired by Rick Williams, released their report on how to preserve our farmlands. The Williams report was informed by consultations with farmers, developers, and recreational land users. I believe that our shift in focus to small and medium-sized businesses in Nova Scotia must reflect long-term thinking around protecting Nova Scotia's land capable of producing food and encouraging the growth of compact, sustainable communities instead of rural sprawl that is costing our municipalities much more than can be afforded. I commend the work of the No Farms, No Food organization in my riding that have been instrumental in ensuring our province has a farmland trust. Mr. Speaker, I have tackled the issue of land use from two angles, as an architect and through chairing two municipal planning advisory committees. Conflicts in land use for the siting of landfills, new development, agricultural uses, recreational uses, gravel pits, and wind farms. These conflicts abound in this province. I was surprised to see in the province's Environmental Goals and Prosperity Act that land use is not mentioned. Perhaps it is time for Nova Scotia to reflect on the link between land use and sustainability and consider a land use framework for the province. Mr. Speaker, I would now like to turn to a subject close to my heart, and that is the future of towns in Nova Scotia. I've had the privilege of serving on two municipal councils in two jurisdictions, in Iqaluit, Canada's newest capital city, just after the creation of the territory in 1999, and here in this province in Wolfville, the fastest growing community in Nova Scotia. I know that a number of my colleagues here have arrived at Province House with valuable experience in municipal politics behind them. It is my hope that in the 62nd General Assembly, we can make the most of this collective municipal experience by working collaboratively with the Union of Nova Scotia on actions that will improve the fiscal sustainability of our communities, and in particular, our rural communities. We began to tackle the issue of fiscal health in Wolfville by creating a fiscal sustainability task force, which I had the pleasure of chairing. We examined the long-term trends of tax revenue, including the tax inequities created by the property assessment cap and we looked at the declining state of our infrastructure, particularly our roads. Mr. Speaker, the Federation of Canadian Municipalities have effectively laid out the extent of the infrastructure deficit in Canada. It is a national issue played out in the crumbling roads and sidewalks of our Nova Scotia towns and cities. As provincial legislatures, we can use our voice to advocate for a robust and sustained federal infrastructure program. We can also play a key role in supporting and encouraging community-driven initiatives to examine more cost-effective municipal governance structures. It is clear to me Nova Scotians know it is time to seriously examine municipal governance and regional cooperation. I know more regional cooperation between municipalities can be part of the solution because I saw it firsthand as chairperson of Valley Waste Resource Management Board. Valley Waste manages solid waste on behalf of 8 municipalities in the Annapolis Valley. It's a cost-effective and efficient model for regional service delivery. Mr. Speaker, as I meet with business owners in Colebrook and New Minas and throughout the riding, I hear a common complaint about governments thwarting their growth and success because of a burden of regulatory requirements and fees. They view the many rules, costly applications, and filings from different levels of government as time-consuming and an expensive barrier to their business's success. As our government shifts focus to small and medium-sized businesses, I believe we must include in this strategy a fresh look at what can be done to streamline the regulatory requirements for small business. And it's not just the business community that feels the burden of administrative processes. In my riding, 2 exceptional citizens, Kathy Menko and Janet Roberts, are quietly assisting individuals and families who use the Wolfville Food Bank in accessing low-income programs that require social assistance numbers and birth certificates, documentation that most people simply don't have. These 2 remarkable volunteers not only make low-income families aware of programs that they are entitled, but assist them in making applications for services and support for which they are entitled. I refer to this as the Food Bank Plus program, and this is an idea worth replicating throughout this province. Mr. Speaker, after meeting with thousands of families in King's South in the weeks leading up to October 8th, I can assure you that investing in improvements in quality education is at the top of many parents' lists of priorities for this government. I am sure all of my colleagues can share stories from families of children with special needs who are simply not getting the services needed, including mental health services. Inadequate special needs programming impacts directly on students who need additional supports. Inadequate special needs programming impacts directly on students who need additional supports, on their parents, and on students, classmates, and teachers. Our commitment to reinvesting in education must include frontline investments in special education services. Mr. Speaker, in my role as a parent, along with my years of a town councillor in Wolfville, I have sharpened my thinking about the role that schools serve in our communities. Our strategy for rural communities, or rural health delivery, or rural roads, is inextricably bound to our strategy for investing in schools. We must do everything within the means of this government to be forward-thinking about our investment in schools. Mr. Speaker, it would be remiss of me not to offer my utmost support for the work going on in our government right now on evaluating and updating our continuing care strategy for seniors. I had many conversations with seniors during the campaign, and 99% of the time, they were more than gracious in offering their opinion about how our government can improve services for seniors. We have many seniors living on their own without family support, so I heard reasoned and modest suggestions for services that could improve their ability to access existing health services. The review of our continuing care strategy is an indication to our seniors that we will not forget them. Our government's plan to streamline health administration so Nova Scotians can access treatment faster will directly impact many seniors that I have talked to in King's South who are on lengthy waiting lists for treatment. Mr. Speaker, each and every day I walk into this historic building of Province House, I am reminded that I'm here because of the remarkable people who have played a role in my life, beginning with my parents, who introduced me at a young age to what it meant to be part of community building, in their instance, through the arts world. My father, Ron Irving's career was dedicated to his community of Prince Edward Island, telling the important stories of rural life and rural values. He is a man of great integrity. And honesty, and he's been recognized, excuse me, with the Order of Canada, for which I am very proud. My mother, Daphne Irving, is also dedicated to her community through her church work and her art, and she has been honored by the Royal Canadian Academy, and her paintings hang in many corners of this country. The support my parents provided myself and my sisters, Martha Irving and Ann Mack, have allowed us all to achieve so much. I also must credit my dad for the single most important sports decision of my life, introducing me as a young boy to Fenway Park and the Boston Red Sox. There were actually two wonderful red victories for me this October. I also want to publicly acknowledge and thank my wife, Catherine Trumper, who I met while living in Canada's Arctic. Catherine is a brilliant and talented woman who has supported me through five campaigns, and in the most recent election took on the role of my campaign manager. Her talents in managing and motivating people helped build a tremendous team of volunteers. She has sacrificed so much to allow me to pursue a career in public service, and I thank her from the bottom of my heart. My son Simon, who was born in Nunavut and is now attending his second year at Dalhousie University, has given up his time with Dad on many a night so that I can pursue my passion for public service, and I want to thank Simon for his support. And I must complete the family thank yous by acknowledging our family dog, Fenway.
Good name.
Our Nova Scotia duck tolling retriever, the official dog of Nova Scotia, campaigned beside me in several parades, and I am absolutely certain that she secured a few votes for me. Mr. Speaker, I want to conclude my remarks today by paying tribute and offering my sincerest thanks to my remarkable campaign team of over 60 citizens in King's South, and I would like to table a document with the list. In particular, I would like to recognize the dedication of my official agent, John Mraz, and a core team that included Pat and Vera Burke, Christine Pinch, David Daniels, Eric Smith, Kim Manette, Evan Farron, Jerry Robertson, Francis Jacobson, Jody DeLong, Bob Trenholm, Bob Prang, Brunel Lyons, Elwood Dillman, and also the incoming generation of supporters, students from Acadia and NSCC, Connor McNeil, Jake Schofield, Christiane Robichaud, Rachel Lutz, Christopher Iananu, Laura Dunn, and David Houston Gouge. There are many others, and I am so very grateful for their individual and collective contribution. I also want to acknowledge the help and mentoring of my colleague, from Kings County, the Honourable Member from Kings West, for his unwavering help and guidance these past few months. One other veteran of Nova Scotia politics who has been immensely helpful to me, including canvassing me with me on numerous occasions, is the Member of Parliament for King's Hants, Scott Bryson. Mr. Bryson showed me how to sprint from door to door during the campaign. I'm indebted to both these fine people for tutoring me in the many roles of a politician. Mr. Speaker, in the coming weeks, through a series of resolutions, I will be acknowledging the contributions of many remarkable citizens of King's South, past and present, who have made extraordinary contributions to the vibrancy of the communities throughout the riding. Every day, I am inspired by the initiative shown by citizens in community building, like the individuals leading the effort to rebuild the Black River Community Hall that burned down 2 years ago. The resolve of deeply committed citizens to do what is necessary to strengthen their communities provides me with guidance and motivation where I can play a role in strengthening the community building process. Mr. Speaker, in closing, I want to ensure the citizens of King South that on each and every day of the life of this government, I will represent their individual and collective concerns to our government. I have seen from my colleague, the Honourable Minister of Health and MLA from King's West, and my MP, Scott Bryson, what is meant by being a good constituency MLA or MP, and I will apply these lessons to my work with the citizens in King's South. Mr. Speaker, earlier in my remarks, I commented on the extraordinary sense of history I feel entering this House. Some of that sense of history is influenced by the small but important glimpse into my own family history that I carry with me today in the form of my great-great-grandfather's Mariner papers. Each and every day, our early citizens took enormous risks and overcame challenges that we now see as incremental steps in the process of province building. It is our time now, and I look forward to working with all MLAs in the complex and demanding issues that lie ahead for this assembly. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Member for Chester St. Margaret's on an introduction.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. It is with delight today that I would like to introduce to the House of Assembly students from the Aspatagan Consolidated Elementary School. Yes, you can clap for yourself. It is a fabulous school in Mill Cove. And we have 27 students here from grades 4 and 5. And I would like to also recognize their chaperones today, David Kokachi, Pat Wardall, and Suzanne Campbell. And thank you. And I'd like to say that their principal, Ms. Paula Baker, has been a great initiator in teaching the children of Aspatagan Consolidated School, ACES we call it, to learn more about politics. And so they were all involved in the student vote, and I had the privilege not so very long ago to be invited to the school to talk about what it is like to be an MLA. And you would not believe the very insightful questions that they asked. So it's with great pleasure for me as their representative to introduce them today and receive a warm welcome from this host. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Member for Colchester, Musquodoboit Valley.
First of all, Mr. Speaker, it is a true honour for me to rise in this House of Assembly as a representative of Colchester, Musquodoboit Valley. A little over a year ago, I decided to retire after 41 years of ministry in the United Church of Canada. And in that retirement plan, I was going to pick up my curling again, pick up my golf again, go south for a bit and spend time with my grandkids. Well, one day there was a knock on my door, and a few folks walked in. They wanted to talk to me. So when they asked if I would run for the Progressive Conservative Party, my mouth just fell open. The thought never, ever crossed my mind that I would be here. My brother, Bev, has been in the PC government in New Brunswick for many, many years, 23, in fact, as an MLA and as speaker for two terms. But I told that that group of people that I would just think it over for a bit, and I would get back to them. Eventually, my family and I decided that stepping away from serving a congregation in Nova Scotia, such as Brookfield and Middle Stewiac, and being a representative in this house was not a big stretch. They have placed their trust in me, and I'm going to work hard to honor that trust. I know it's not going to be an easy road, and I found that out very quickly. Because when I announced to my congregations that I was going to run for the PC party in this election, some cheered, some clapped. Some looked at me as if I was going on the road to sing, and you know I cannot sing. And some just sat there, didn't do a thing, and I knew I wouldn't get their vote. So I knew up front it was going to be a tough time. And from that day on, it indeed was a whirlwind. Our campaign team, it came together very, very quickly. It was made up of people I have known for a good many years, such as Andy and Vera Faye and Jeff and Linda and Tammy. In fact, I baptized all of Tammy's three children. And then, of course, my wife Suzanne, my daughter Stacy, my son Brent, who did a lot of work on the campaign as well. And then, of course, there are a lot of people that I just met. Randy and Morris and Patsy, Lloyd, Steve, Roseanne. Penny was the official agent, and she kept a very tight rein on what was going to happen. There were so many people who worked on the campaign and donated money to my campaign because they believed in the democratic process and wanted to see things move. They believed in me, and because they did, it was almost an overwhelming feeling. Politics is a new world for me. So all of the energy and experience that the volunteers brought to the campaign was certainly invaluable. And when anyone asked me how things were going, Mr. Speaker, in my campaign, I always said that I had met a lot of very nice people, very committed people. And I truly appreciate every bit of work that was done on my behalf. And you know, I wish I could thank every single person who worked on the campaign and donated money. But there are a lot of people. And I signed thank you notes to the point I thought it would never end. But it's done. I feel good about it, and I think they feel good. And you know what? I also want to thank everyone who volunteered to work for Gary Burrell and Tom Martin as well. They did a fantastic job. It was a clean campaign, and I enjoyed my time with them. The returning officer was also from my area, Sharon O'Leary. And she handled the returning office and did a fantastic job in making the election go fairly smooth in our area. And of course, I have to give a thank you to who has turned out to be a friend, and also my member of parliament, and that is Scott Armstrong. Scott was invaluable in helping me through the campaign process and was with me on many occasions. I'm especially excited, you know, to work with Scott, and we're going to strive to make things better in this province. We both have the feeling that people have to come first, and I am certainly looking forward to working with him, working with the municipality, because one thing we have found out is that when the three levels of government work together, good things will happen. Municipal, provincial, as well as federal. During my campaign, I started to hear how people really feel about politicians. I'm not sure I'm going to tell you everything, but but it was my close friends and congregants who were really honest with me. They had known me in the last 35 years there to be honest, that they could come to me at any time, to be compassionate when they did come. And they had a question mark in their minds, is being a politician going to change who I am? For some reason, many people think that this House of Assembly is just the opposite of being honest, caring, and compassionate. So many don't see that we are here to serve because they believe they have little say in what we do and how it affects them. They only hear the side of politics that the media will like to portray. The few who are in it for themselves rather than to serve the people, but there's only a few. I think of the many good politicians who served our area for many years, Bob Stanfield and Ike Smith, Colin Stewart, Ken Stretch, Brooke Taylor, Gary Burrell. These are all MLAs that served the people of Colchester, Musquodoboit Valley with honor, and I plan to follow in their footsteps. Near the end of my campaign, I was when those kids walked in, I was thinking about them and how they see things. This story was told to me from a resident, and some of the folks know it here. A grandmother came up to me one day and said that she picked up her 12-year-old grandson from school, and they were discussing politics that day, going over what was happening in the election and so on. And the grandmother said that she picked the child up, they got in the car, dead silence. And eventually the little fella said, Graham, is Mr. Harrison a minister? And she said, yes. Is he going to be a politician? She said, yes. Dead silence. Isn't that a sin? We're going to have a chat sometime. These are very serious times, you know, and it's going to require very serious leadership. This is not a time in the history of the province to play the games, I'm really not here to do that. At one time, people would joke about what politicians did and how they reacted to each other. But you know, today people just don't laugh anymore. It's a different environment. They're asking for a very common sense approach to the needs of the province. Over the last year, more than 4,000 people left Nova Scotia to go to work elsewhere. Whole families have just picked up and moved because there's really nothing for them here. Mr. Speaker, Nova Scotians really don't care who brings the common sense changes. Let's be honest, about 95% of Nova Scotians, when it comes to political parties, doesn't mean a thing. There are some, but not very many. They see us as all the same, the yellow, the red, the blue. We need to be able to show them that they're right, that underneath the blue, underneath the yellow, underneath the red, the orange, that we are all the same, that we are all the same. Because every one of us in this house wants people to get back to work. We want to have better health care. We want to know that our children are going to have good education. We all want every single one of the roads paved. Okay.
One minister to another.
Anyway, I think we all just want better lives for our constituents. That's why we're here. And I think that's why our constituents put us here, to do that. They want the government that's going to listen to their concerns. And to them, the government is just a big, faithless, faceless monster. But it isn't, is it? It's just you and me. We are the people who can meet with our constituents. We can listen to their concerns and hopefully be able to solve a lot of their issues. We want people to be happy. We want farmers to produce. We want businesses to prosper. But we aren't experts. So we're going to need to go to these people and find out exactly what they do need to be happy, be productive, and also to be prosperous. And maybe that just means getting out of the way sometimes. One of the things that has always bothered me when I talk to people is the regulations when they go to do something. They're taxed and permitted and regulated to death. We all know that a vast majority of our constituents are good people who are honest, they're hardworking. But for the sake of those few out there who are not cooperative, we throw up roadblocks for everybody. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could just cut through all of that red tape and regulations that are holding back those who are careful and able to use their own common sense? We know the rules are in place for a reason, but if someone falls just outside that little circle that we have put there, put in place by governments, they are held off as though they are the ones that are abusing the system. We all know many good and honest people who are hurt because they play by the rules while they watch others find a way to get around the rules. Mr. Speaker, the red tape and regulations not only hurt good, hardworking folks, it also impacts on businesses and in our communities. Colchester, Musquodoboit Valley is dotted with many small, medium-sized, large businesses. Bill and Lois Spinney are running the Greenfield Golf Course that became an 18-hole course from a 9-hole course in 1991. I'm very proud to announce that Brookfield has had an 18-hole course for many, many years. In Clifton, the Blois family molds knives that are sold all over the world, and they can be made in 48 hours. Marwood Limited in Brookfield has been a part of our constituency for 90 years. And the Creelman family started their business in Upper Stewiacke. They have plants and offices all across Atlantic Canada. And they have been one fantastic support to me over the years. The pellet mill in Middle Musquodoboit, my son worked there for many years. It has now been taken over by a Vancouver company. The Stretch family of Elderbank. They produce 800 acres of nursery, and a nursery sod a year acres of nursery sod a year, and they have Grandview Farms and Muscadabit Valley Quality Sod. Brookfield has a sod company as well. More than $480 million come from the airport, come from businesses around the airport, such as Pratt & Whitney, Northrop Grumman Canada. The economic diversity in this constituency is fantastic. Now, businesses are more than just bricks and mortar. They are the taxes that keep our province running. They are the jobs that keep our residents working. And they are the stability that keep our communities very strong. We have more than a dozen volunteer fire departments in our constituency that work very hard to keep us safe. These volunteer firefighters rely on us to keep our province prosperous so that they are employed close to home and have the time and ability to rush to the scene of an accident when needed. Now, whether it's economic development or education or healthcare, we need to assure that we will do our best for the people of Nova Scotia. In Colchester, Muscadabit Valley, we have two main hospitals. One is the Memorial Hospital in Muscadabit and the Colchester Regional Hospital. Both facilities have exceptional frontline workers that put patients first. I know I volunteered for years with the palliative care team in the Colchester Hospital, and I got to see firsthand what is done. And I understand, and I would, I know he is, the Minister of Health and Wellness will be visiting people, visiting these hospitals. And I'm going to say right now, if I can be of any help in going with him to these hospitals, I would be more than willing to do so. Because we really do need to work together to strengthen the services that we provide. I have had a goal through this, by the way, and I have shared that goal with my family, with my friends. My vision is to have the welfare of the province come first. People are really ready to put party politics behind them. They're ready. We need to set the tone here amongst us in this room. It will carry over into every single area that we're able to influence. I heard the Honourable Premier allude to this, as did the Honourable Leader of the Opposition. And this is my goal as well. And I can assure you that this Assembly will work hard to meet the needs of Nova Scotians. And you know what? I want to work really hard with them. I will stand up for the people in my constituency. I will let them know about the issues that are affecting them. Roads that need to be paved, culverts that need to be replaced. I'm sorry about this. To the Minister, we're going to have a chat later. We'll have a chat later. For some reason, it has been a practice just to do patchwork, and there's a lot of patchwork in our area that needs to be redone because of even flooding. Flooding has been a major problem in our area for a long time. Mr. Speaker, I think we can all agree that changes need to be made in the province. That's why each and every one of us agreed to put our names on the ballot back in October. We want to make Nova Scotia better for this generation and the generations to come. That's our goal. And folks, whether it's Liberal, NDP, Conservative, I want to work with you for the betterment of this province. That's my dream. That's my goal. I want to work with my constituents to help make Nova Scotia better for them. Just as an aside, I want to close with this. Our constituency office is now open, and it's at Mastodon Ridge on your way through to Truro. And when I'm sitting in the legislature or at a meeting, I know that my constituency assistant, Paula Henderson, is very, very hard at work. She has carried things for the last number of weeks, and I want to thank her for that. She shares my goal. She shares our goal. A strong, prosperous, vibrant Nova Scotia where everyone can live to their greatest potential. So thank you very much for listening, folks. It's a pleasure to be here, and I look forward to working with you over the next 4 years.
Just a couple of quick housekeeping notes here, folks, before we proceed. As I'm reading the rule book while listening to the tremendous remarks of the honorable members, I'm reminded that it's unparliamentary to not face the House while other honorable members are speaking. And I'm also reminded that when members are doing introductions, it is unparliamentary to speak directly to the guests in the gallery, as well as unparliamentary to encourage our guests in the gallery to express any form of approval or disapproval of the business that's going on the floor of the chamber. So I just want to pass on those couple of housekeeping notes. I'm doing my homework. The honorable member for Halifax, Chibucto.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. First, let me start by saying, wow, what an honor it is to be standing in the House as an elected official in the riding of Halifax-Chibucto. What a great privilege it is to have the opportunity to say a few words in response to the speech from the throne. I would first like to acknowledge everyone who is in this chamber. As someone who does not come from a political background, I have great respect and admiration for hard work that we all have signed up for to represent the people in our constituencies. Your dedication to this province is inspiring. I'd like to start my speech by taking a moment to acknowledge two people who dedicated their lives to the riding of Halifax-Chibucto. First, Alexa McDonough, who became the first woman to lead a major recognized political party in Canada when she was elected the Nova Scotia Democrat Party leader in 1980. She served as the member of the Nova Scotia Legislature from 1981 to 1994, representing Halifax-Chibucto and Halifax-Fairview electoral district. She stepped down as the Nova Scotia NDP's leader and as member of legislature in 1994. She subsequently ran for and was elected as leader of the Federal New Democratic Party in 1995. McDonough was elected to the Member of Parliament for the Federal Electric District of Halifax in 1997. She stepped down as the party leader in 2000. And three, I remember her growing up and admire her dedication and powerful representation of Nova Scotia legislature on the national stage. And second, I would like to acknowledge Howard Epstein, first elected to Halifax City Council in 1994. He was re-elected in 1996 with the formation of the Halifax Regional Municipality. Epstein sat as a councillor for District 14, Connaught and Quimple, representing the city's West End. On March 24, 1998, Epstein was elected to the Nova Scotia House of Assembly for the New Democratic Party, representing the provincial riding of Halifax-Chibucto. He was elected in 1999 and served until the 2013 general elections. So I have big shoes to fill representing Halifax-Chibucto in this chamber. Am I ready? You bet I am. I grew up in this riding. I'm a first-generation Canadian who comes from a hard-working Dutch family. My father retired from Dalhousie University as the Dean of Physics and Biomedical Engineering, and my mother, who retired from the IWK as a child life specialist on the oncology unit. The two of them raised me with strong values of the importance of community and family, and I now live in the Halifax-Chibucto riding with my wife and two young daughters. In order for me to be standing here, it took tremendously a talented team who believed that together we could govern differently. I'd like to thank my campaign manager, Sean Cleary, and Michelle Dagnont. Sean knocked on doors for me for over 9 months before the election was called. With his help, we were able to knock on every door before the election was called, and we listened to so many people. Michelle Dagnont worked behind the scenes for many months prior to the election and also knocked on many doors. Mr. Speaker, I would also like to thank Dr. John Gillis, who put this idea of running into my head. I'd like to thank Martin McKinnon, Colin Piercy, Daniel Burnoak, Liam Daly, who's in the East Gallery here, Patricia Donnelly, Mary Hope, Anna LaRue, PJ Cowan, Jane O'Neill, and Leo Artiletto, and finally, Joan Frazier. By the way, Joan told me on election night that she could now die peacefully, knowing that there was finally a Liberal in the riding of Shabakto. And most of all, I'd like to thank all the volunteers that helped me within this riding. This was 100% team effort, so thank you. There's also three people who deserve a big thank you. First, my amazing and patient wife and my soulmate, April. We have known each other for over 20 years and have been married for 13. April has been the biggest driving force to keeping work and family balanced. You see, she happens to be married to someone who is both ADD and dyslexic, so clearly she's a very patient, committed woman. The next two I have to thank are my daughters, Annika, who is 9, and Zafaya, who is 6. These two knocked on doors with me, pounding in signs into the lawn, and most of all, gave me a hug when I needed. So thank you to my lovely daughters. Mr. Speaker, I need to share a small piece of history of the Halifax-Shabakto riding. In 1931, Bluebell Farms between Shabakto Road and Bears Road. This was the location of the first airfield in Halifax. Today, this airfield is marked by Saunders Field. And then in the 1950s, their airfields were turned into the Victory Houses. And many of the streets are named after famous war heroes. One of these war heroes is the grandson of the great Lebanese, the first Lebanese immigrants to come to Nova Scotia, Abraham and Annie Arab. He would be the second cousin of the MLA of Fairview-Clayton Park. Lieutenant Edward Francis Arab, who died on October 25th, 1944 in the Netherlands, was helping to free my parents' homeland. So I'm grateful to the Arab family and to many other Canadians who gave up their lives to free my parents' homeland and my second home, the Netherlands. Mr. Speaker, now I need to address what really brought me to these chambers, my love of Nova Scotia. This place has 7,400 kilometers of coastline, and where you can still go into the backcountry, like the places like the Tobiatic Wilderness Reserve, and not see anybody for days. We are very lucky to have such a magical place for the outdoors, but Nova Scotia is struggling in many ways, and we really need to ask ourselves, especially in these great chambers, what will it take to make Nova Scotia thrive? In every one of our ridings, we have amazing people who have great love for this province, and all they want to do is make this place better to live. So the first thing we need to do is listen to these great people as they have great ideas that will make Nova Scotia thrive. If that past government had taken the time to listen to me and my colleagues, then maybe I would not be here today, and they still might be in power. But this is the past, so let's look on to the future and let's listen to the people around us. No matter how crazy their idea is, their idea may be the one that will make Nova Scotia thrive. Mr. Speaker, I would be amiss if I did not also address small businesses in Nova Scotia. As you know, I own and operate several small businesses in Nova Scotia. At one time, my wife and I had over 40 employees, but today we have 25. Small businesses are struggling right now in Nova Scotia. Retail is probably one of the hardest businesses to be in because of the cost of doing business in Nova Scotia. It's one of the highest in North America. Power rates going up, Nova Scotia has made it easier and cheaper for big box stores to do business in our province. Standing here, I do not have the answers to fix these problems, but no, I have the capacity to listen to my colleagues and bring solutions forefront, where we can all debate these ideas in these chambers. Within the next 4 years, I will work tirelessly to make Nova Scotia a great place to own and operate small businesses. Mr. Speaker, within that in mind, I would like to throw out a challenge. In December 2011, a proclamation was read in the House by the Honourable Minister Piercy Parris, where all parties agreed to the concept of shift 10%. So I ask you, when you are out shopping for gifts for your family and friends this year, see if you can buy 10% more of your gifts from local businesses. By leading this, and making this kind of an effort, it shows Nova Scotians that we actually care that our money stays in Nova Scotia. If more money stays in Nova Scotia, then we'll be able to have the health care, the roads, and the education for our children that we all want. We'll have a more robust economy that will enable us to fix roads in Lunenburg County and keep ERs open or build new schools in Spryfield. This is, of course, will help people stay in Nova Scotia, and we need to lead by example. And I hope that all my fellow MLAs will take this challenge on. Especially today, but Mr. Speaker, I also want to acknowledge all the women in the House. As a father of two young daughters, it is great for them to see all these women as great leaders in our community. We have women as leaders of a party, as women as ministers, and of MLAs. These women will set the tone for many young girls in this province, including my daughters. So I thank you for your service and showing young women that you can be and do anything. Mr. Speaker, in conclusion, I ask that all political parties treat each other as humans, with respect that we can do not turn our back on the leaders of the parties while they speak, that we conduct ourselves in a manner that Nova Scotians can be proud of, that our youth can look up to us and say, wow, even though they have different views and opinions, they treat each other with the utmost respect. I want to come to a work in a place where everyone is respected and valued, and I look forward to working with all of you and to make Nova Scotia a place where people and communities and businesses will thrive. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Well done.
Thank you.
I recognize the Government House Leader.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. That concludes the government's business for today. I certainly want to thank all members of the House for their cooperation as we work through our business today. For Monday, we will meet again on Monday, the hours of 4 p.m. until 10 p.m. Business will be a second reading of government bills, number 19, number 20, as well as some bills in Committee of the Whole, and if time permits, possibly some third reading and address in reply. With that, Mr. Speaker, I would move that the House do now rise.
Motion is that the House rise to meet again on Monday, December the 9th, between the hours of 4 p.m. and 10 p.m. Would those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. Motion is carried. We stand adjourned until 4 p.m. Monday.